weird, that's all.
What's that, Herb?
Oh, that guy in Bellevue that killed his whole family. Cut him up with knives.
That a man could be driven to do something like that to his own family, to his children. I don't even want to know about it.
Makes you wonder, though. What's it take to make a guy turn his family into Gainsburgers?
Maybe they disappointed him.
Hello, and welcome to TCM Slumber Ground, the pre-show party for TCM Underground, which airs every Friday night, late night, on Turner Classic Movies. My name is Millie DeCherico. I'm the programmer for TCM Underground. And once again, I am joined by my esteemed TCM colleagues, Ben, Toya, and Matthew. For this episode, we're getting into a 1980s double feature all about step-parents. Divorce was on the rise in the 80s, and there were many films in this decade that focused in on this complicated family situation. We'll first discuss a thriller directed by Joseph Rubin from 1987 called The Stepfather, followed by the Larry Cohen-directed comedy horror film Wicked Stepmother from 1989. As always, I'd like to kick things off with Matthew giving us a brief synopsis of The Stepfather.
The Stepfather tells the story of Jerry Blake, played by Terry O'Quinn, who I think most people know him from the television show Lost. We're introduced to Jerry before the opening credits, and right off the bat, we learn very quickly that he's up to no good. And it appears that Jerry is a serial killer with different identities and disguises who meets single women and kind of worms his way into their lives before ultimately killing them. And this time, the unlucky family are Stephanie and Susan Main, played by Shelley Hack and Jill Sholin. Jill Sholin's probably pretty recognizable to people because she was in a lot of horror and thriller movies in the late 80s, including When a Stranger Calls Back, which we've covered on this show, and the movies Popcorn and Cutting Class with Brad Pitt.
Okay, Toya, I know that you're always the one who provides us with some historical context for all the films that we discuss on Slumber Ground, but I have to ask, is it true that The Stepfather is actually based on a true crime?
Loosely based on the true crime serial killer, John List, who killed his mom and his children and his wife. Serial killers were more and more known by this point, but you know, that's more of kind of what the fear that this is touching on. And I think that this movie does it brilliantly because, as Matthew mentioned, those kind of first few minutes gives you everything you need to know about this character. No one speaks, no one does anything, but you just get this menacing shot of Jerry in the mirror cleaning himself after this murder. He's so calm, he's so calculated, he's so menacing. And then as he walks down the stairs, you see the carnage and how vicious he is. It's filmed like a horror movie, but it has these kind of Lifetime original movie vibes to it. So it's true crime, but then it's this like family drama. And then there are shots that are just straight up out of, you know, almost like Friday the 13th inspired. There's fog everywhere for no reason. At first I was like, is this an Adrian Lyne film? Like what's going on here? But I just think, yeah, it's a brilliant movie that mixes so many genres to make this absolutely terrifying.
Yeah, it kind of makes sense that the primal fear of the film is sort of like, who is the new guy that's coming to marry my mom? And he might be a serial killer.
Sweet dreams, Steph.
That seems like a proper teenage fear in the 80s.
Night, Jerry.
That's one of the things I liked about it is that it was like all kind of a daytime horror movie. Like I'd always kind of heard of it as a slasher movie. And when I was watching, I was like, oh, this kind of just feels like Night of the Hunter set in Seattle in the 80s and like Reagan times.
I think the really famous line from it too is really scary still, like where he looks at the mom and says,
who am I here?
And it's just, I don't know, it's so crazy and creepy.
He has so many creepy lines.
Now, let's go ahead and take a hard turn and get into 1989's Wicked Stepmother. Now, to me, this film is a genuine curiosity. And I am eager to see what everybody thought of it. But first, Matthew, would you mind giving us another one of your synopses for this film?
So, you know, when you have a dream and you wake up and you try to describe it right after you just had it and things don't really connect or make sense. And you're just trying to figure out, oh, how was I from here to point A to point B in my dream? I don't know if it's the troubled production of this movie that accounts for this, but I find this movie really hard to follow, but I'll give it my best shot of giving you a synopsis for it. So the story actually centers on Steve and Jenny Fisher, played by David Raschi and Colleen Camp, who live with Jenny's father, Sam, played by Lionel Stander. They return home from vacation to discover that their father has suddenly married a mysterious new woman named Miranda, who's played by Bette Davis in her final film role. And she starts to influence a lot of Sam's behavior, and then just some wacky magical things start to happen. There's a smoking cat. As Jenny starts trying to piece together who this mysterious woman is, it's complicated even further by the arrival of Miranda's daughter, Priscilla, played by Barbara Carrera. And things just keep getting stranger and stranger from there. And I think it's probably the best possible synopsis you could get for this film.
You actually did way better than I could have even imagined. That's
Well, speaking of Bette Davis, like, I know it's no secret that she is the star of this film, star of classic films for decades, but there's also lots of other kind of classic movie references that are tucked into Wicked Stepmother. Ben, what did you find when you were watching this movie?
Yeah, so in general, like, Larry Cohen has a lot of nods to old Hollywood in a lot of his movies and uses a lot of old Hollywood stars. And so he put some Easter eggs in this movie. And there's a photo in the background of Colin Camp's first mother, and it's Joan Crawford. So it's a little nod to their Whatever Happened to Baby Jane and their just kind of entire feud. And there's also a shot where they're walking down Hollywood Boulevard, and in the background, there's a mural that has a picture of Bette Davis in there. And when they go to Richard Mull's detective office, there's a falcon on the desk, which is an homage to the Maltese Falcon. And then my personal favorite, the end credits, they do a roll call of all the cast of characters for the film.
May we introduce our cast of players?
And which is an homage to my favorite Orson Welles film, The Magnificent Ambersons.
Bette Davis.
Call me Mom.
Where he does that at the end of the credits too. There's a lot of important Hollywood history going on in this movie.
I want to talk a little bit about Larry Cohen as a director of this film. And I have to say, by Larry Cohen's standards, this movie seems strange. And it's one of those films, it's one of those films that has this kind of storied production history. And a lot of it is that Bette Davis actually left the film in the middle of it. She was set to be the star of the film and then walked off the set and never came back. And they had to do a lot of pivoting after that happened, which explains the idea that her daughter comes to town and there's this cat that she embodies. And I just was curious if anybody had thoughts about that and sort of the idea, I think, generally of when a movie has to turn bizarre because something crazy happens, you know?
I think it really reminds me of like Ed Wood, you know, it's like where like Larry Cohen kind of operated outside of the Hollywood system, and he was kind of known for just like doing anything to get a shot. You know, he would like do guerrilla filmmaking in New York and just like not get permission to get shots and not tell anybody on the street that they're filming. So I think, you know, this is an example of him just rolling with the punches. He was like, okay, Bette Davis walked out, we'll bring in a stepdaughter and they'll transfer bodies through a cat. And so, I mean, you know, like famously for Plan 9, Bela Lugosi dies during the production. He's like, we'll cut around it and get someone with a cape and we'll do this the whole movie.
Yeah.
Bingo, bango. You know, we're back in business. So
there was a lot of Ed Wood in this movie, down to the tentacles coming off of the tree or whatever towards the end. It felt very Plan 9 to me.
That part looked like a like weird late 80s Ken Russell, maybe like a Derek Jarman movie. I was like, it totally looked like some kind of weird underground video art installment. I was like, it kind of renewed me again at the end when things were getting weird.
To Ben's point about, you know, Larry Cohen being more of this kind of visual stylist, like stylistic director, I think that really kind of shows in this where it's the visuals that take precedent over the actual story. Bette Davis has this fantastic interview that she did in with LA Times in like 1989, where she basically defends why she walked off of set, why she didn't like this movie. And her biggest thing was, like, you know, Larry Cohen didn't listen. She, you know, saw the rushes of this and was just like, what is this? What, this is the worst thing I've ever seen. And so I think that there are just so many parts of this movie that don't work, but then it kind of works for me, at least. Like, I really enjoyed this movie. Like, I really had a good time with this. I thought it was hilarious. And even just kind of going back, scanning for scenes, I found myself like rewatching it over again. And it's like a movie that I'm excited to watch again. It has to be seen to be believed kind of movie that words can't describe how off the wall it is. You have to see it for yourself.
I think when we first brought up the movie, I said, isn't that the movie where Betty Davis turns into a cat? And everybody was kind of like, what?
It still makes me laugh.
To me, that's not even the craziest part of that movie. To me, there's so many other weirder, wilder, crazier things than Betty Davis turning into a cat and smoking.
Well, and the thing that makes this film even more interesting is that there's so many good people in it. So not just like the classic film actors like Betty Davis, Lionel Standing, like Evelyn Keyes, this was her last movie. But then you have a mini Death Game reunion with Colleen Camp and Seymour Cassell, who plays the guy that owns the occult bookstore on Hollywood Boulevard or wherever they are. And you have Tom Bosley, who was the dad from Happy Days / Father Dowling. He's in the film playing a detective. And also, we have to move into this because I really want to talk about this. So I want you guys' take on witch movies, because obviously there's a lot of witch themed things happening in Wicked Stepmother, and I feel like you guys have a little bit more to say about the genre.
I just love that witch movies were so big in the 80s. You know, we did the graph of the deaths in jacuzzis. I think we need to do one for how many movies it consisted of witchcraft in the 80s. I think it's a really interesting parallel of the satanic panic that was going on, but then it's also, you know, it's this post-70s, because there's a lot of witchcraft movies in the 70s as well, or witch-based, but they're more of the darker, you know, Rosemary's Baby, Exorcist kind of inspired ones. And then when we get into the 80s, it's still there, but then it gets more into the lighthearted, you know, silly types of movies, or where witchcraft is more fun and light. And I think it's such a fascinating turn that it takes in the 80s, though.
As somebody who grew up just loving, you know, something like Bewitched, I think that sort of could be like the starting point for some of that. To Toya's point, as you got into the 80s, like the supernatural, there was a lot more comedy involved with that. You know, I mean, it was almost like anything that was either feminine or a little bit other was sort of seen as silly. And I think that that's something that kind of carried through with witch movies and kind of still does, I think, even to this day. I mean, because if you think about it, there really aren't just like a ton of good witch movies. I mean, you know, until something like The Craft came out in the 90s, I mean, say what you will about that movie, it took it seriously in a way that I don't think a lot of movies had before.
But I think in general, like in the 80s, there was so much horror that it kind of like took a turn, and it was always parodying itself. So like, there was a lot more like lighthearted comedies and tongue-in-cheek horror movies. And I think that's just because the genre had like exploded in the 80s, and there was nothing left to be done, which is why like in the 90s, like Scream came about and Craft came about to kind of like reclaim the seriousness of horror.
Even something like, you know, it's a comedy, but something like Hocus Pocus came out in the early 90s and it didn't do well. You know, I mean, it wasn't until many years later that it actually got a following. You know, I think it was a pretty big failure in terms of box office. So
I think it's interesting how those movies too all basically became cult films, like Hocus Pocus, you have The Craft, you know, I mean, even in the 80s, you have The Worst Witch, you got, you know, Practical Magic, Witches of Eastwick, all of these movies people really clung to. And then just an interesting little like historical factoid, in like 1986, that's when Wicca became officially recognized as a religion. So it's interesting how, you know, at the time there was all these books that were coming out about witchcraft, just about taking the art of witchcraft seriously. You know, it's in the cultural zeitgeist at that time, just these witch movies. And this, I don't know what this movie is trying to do necessarily with witchcraft. It's just it's literally a cauldron of a bunch of things that they've heard about witchcraft that they're just throwing in together. Like, oh, shapeshifters, sure. Broomsticks, yeah. Water over a witch, sure. Why not? Yeah, house turning into stuff, yeah, let's do it. It's like literally every supernatural trope is thrown into this under the guise of witchcraft.
Yeah, you can really tell because the Colleen Camp character is obviously the one whose father is remarried, and she's having that like stepmother panic of like, who is the woman who has married my father? And she suffers from allergy attacks because of the cat in the house. Their entire house gets completely trashed at one point. And you know, then her dad's hair starts growing back. I guess that's a positive witch spell that happened in the movie.
Yeah.
I have to say, like, overall, like, the dad got a good bargain out of this. Like, he came back like younger, stronger, revived, and you know, it was great.
He made a lot of money on a game show by knowing everything in the world.
Young lady made out with him on stage, licked his face at the game show for some reason. That was the thing.
That game show sequence was absolutely wild.
Another weird thing about the movie, it has such like a weird kind of, it feels like it's working for two different audiences. It feels like a kid's movie, like maybe to interest like 10-year-olds, but then it's also a lot of like adult humor in there. Like we have like Betty Davis making like geriatric sex jokes and talking about reading dirty novels.
I'm terribly sorry, but she's...
Oh, don't apologize. You didn't wake me up. I was reading a sexy novel.
It's a very horny movie, and like, but inappropriately horny, because so yes, there's all these other moments of just kind of weird sex jokes, and there's a fully clothed sex tease and emulated masturbation scene behind a bush. It's really weird.
Honestly, like, when it comes down to it, tumultuous film productions are kind of the foundation of TCM Underground, obviously. Yeah. So it's no surprise that this one kind of ended up the way it did, just based on sort of what happened with Betty Davis walking off the set and them having to scramble to find a way to finish the film. But from what I understand, this film actually turned a profit at some point. And I have to wonder if it had something to do with home video, which people like us would watch this movie probably on HBO or something in the middle of the night and laugh along with it, and maybe at some point it made its money back. But I don't know. I just think it's such a fascinating curiosity, because it is, you are watching a film kind of take a turn, and they figured out how to end it at a certain point. And I think that's commendable, to say the least. You finished.
Definitely.
Well, that is about all the time that we have for this episode of TCM Slumberground. As always, I'd like to thank our esteemed TCM colleagues, Ben, Toya, and Matthew. And if you like what you see, please, for the love of God, subscribe to the YouTube channel over at Turner Classic Movies. Like, make nice comments, and also follow us on Twitter at TCM Underground. Until next time, see ya!
Call me Mom.
Kid, creep,
jerk.
Mikey, don't. Mikey, the kid. Mikey.